Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of War Games, the internet's favorite Warhammer and wargaming-based debate show, of course. It's the show where real nerds have real debates about plastic soldiers. And joining me this week are three guests. I am very happy to see how these gentlemen are going to argue. I am very excited about tonight's show, and I hope you are too. So let's meet who we've got tonight. First up, coming to us from across the country there, a frequent guest on Warhammer Weekly there, Caleb Goodson. How you doing, Caleb?
Hello. Quite well. Good to see you.
Absolutely. Also joining us from a little closer here to me on the eastern side of the country is Jeremy. Jeremy Nelson. How you doing, sir?
How's it going, guys?
Absolutely. We got to get you back on Warhammer Weekly sometime soon, buddy. We had a great show when you were on it. I really loved it. I want to do it again sometime soon.
Definitely. Same here.
All right. And finally, of course, a man who everybody knows and loves, our original man who could lose with any Dark Elf army, and a fellow Malifaux enthusiast like myself, it's Nicholas Bollaert. How you doing, Nick?
Great, thanks.
Absolutely. I didn't mean to pick Nick out. It's like, I'm not picking on Nick at the start of the show. He just, you know, he's. I'm not saying anything he hasn't said about himself, so there you go. That's.
Don't worry, you'll pick on all of us eventually.
That's exactly. Right. That is right. All right, so what is War Games? How does the show work? Well, very simply, it's five rounds of debates. I give a question, each of our guests is going to give an answer. Once they've given their answer, they then attack each other like a pack of wild dogs going after a fallen elk. And at the end of that, one of them stands and the others have fallen. And that person gets a point for that round. At the end of five rounds, the person with the most points is declared the War Games winner, and they get to be the king of War Games for two whole weeks until our next show. So, if there is no winner, then we go into the speed round, and the speed round is very exciting. So, we'll see if that happens. It only happened once in all of our shows, so we'll see. Could happen, maybe not, who knows. At any rate, without any further delay, gentlemen, are you ready to fight? Did you come ready to rumble?
We are.
Let's do this.
That's what I like to hear. All right. Let's start it off. Round one. Here we go. By the way, I see you're prepping yourself up there right, Jeremy. That's what I like to see. Getting the thoughts loosened up.
Get loosened up.
Yeah. Get the brain juice flowing. That's good. All right. So, question one. We all know that Warhammer 40K has been the engine driving Games Workshop for quite a while now, probably at least a decade. And my question is, can 40K continue to pull so much weight in an increasingly competitive marketplace? Now, before I pick who's going to start us off here, I believe when I looked at all of your answers, you all had yes, but for different reasons. Okay? And so, I am going to offer you same. This came up last show, too, so I'm very excited. I purposely didn't make you change your answers because I wanted to surprise you. I'm going to offer one of you the devil's advocate choice. You can switch your position right now, argue for the opposite side on the fly. If you win, you get 2 points, okay, knowing that you're arguing from the hip as opposed to your prepared statements. Nobody has to take it, but would anyone like the devil's advocate option? Oh, Jeremy's got his hand up. All right.
So it's kind of easy to answer or to go opposite of what I answered because it's GW.
All right. All right. So Jeremy's taking the devil's advocate position. If he wins, that's 2 points for one round. Big round, but the pressure's on. Shooting from the hip. All right. To start us off this round, it will be Caleb. So, Caleb, can 40K continue to pull so much weight in this increasingly competitive marketplace?
Oh, absolutely it can. 40K is still the strongest miniature game on the market, and it's the 800-pound gorilla. Not only is it strong enough to pull its own weight, but it's the only game that really can venture out into other genres. I mean, 40K has produced comic books, movies, video games, with all varying degrees of success. No other miniature game can really do that, or has the weight. They have the brand name, they have the style, they have everything to keep going. As long as GW doesn't screw things up, which they could, but no, they can definitely continue to be the strongest and most competitive game on the market.
All right. So it's a good answer. I like it. Basically, the size of this thing is pretty big, and it's not an easy thing to stop. Yeah, it's a juggernaut. I get it. All right. Jeremy, you're up next.
All right, so my original answer obviously was yes, but...
sure, but your devil's advocate.
I think my answer that I had sent you kind of still stands. I've been fantasy player forever, and I love playing fantasy. I dabbled a little bit into 40K, just because, I mean, you know, big space marines and orcs, space orcs and all that good stuff. But when I think GW has been kind of hitting me constantly with their price increases and all their like little weird tweaks to everything. And then when they dropped Age of Sigmar, I think that was the straw that broke the camel's back for me with them. And while they do have a huge base, player base for 40K, I'm just waiting for them to screw that up too.
Right.
I mean, I'll give them this. They do have an amazing miniature line, and they do well on the 40K front. But you got War Machine, you got freaking Malifaux, you got all these. Got Warpath, I think, is the Mantic one coming out. They've got a whole lot of people that are nipping at their heels, and they're just all waiting for them to screw up. So.
Okay. Good. So basically you're saying, look, 40K is successful now, but it's just inevitable. The other shoe's going to drop for 40K as well.
Yep. The end of the 40K universe is coming, just like the End of Times did for Warhammer Fantasy.
Okay. All right. Nick, I believe you have us last. So close out with the initial arguments here.
So obviously I'm saying yes, that they can. And basically my position is there's a lot to be said for momentum. 40K is the 800-pound gorilla, as was already stated. And as you stated in the question, the market for these miniature games is getting more and more fractured, especially now in the age of Kickstarter, where we're seeing more and more companies coming in, providing products, and then even going back to the well a second time, opening up multiple Kickstarters. But those companies all need the big game like a 40K that draws people in. You know, I mean, a lot of those miniature companies are essentially making miniatures that they expect people to use in 40K. So a lot of the entire momentum of the industry is riding on it. So they need that. And also, nobody's taking a shot at 40K. I mean, most of the new games are going after the skirmish market. And even, you know, Wormahordes, arguably their biggest competitor, is still only sort of somewhere in the middle. It's not the big army game with tons of giant vehicles and whatnot that 40K is. It's sort of halfway between skirmish and army-based game. And then finally, 40K is the sort of mass that's drawing people in. While there's probably a few people here and there that you could say this about, if you go into a game store and you see people playing Infinity or Malifaux or, you know, Frostgrave or some other, you know, smaller game, they're not going to go, hey, yeah, I was not a miniatures gamer before and I saw Infinity and I just picked it up. They all came from 40K or other big games like it, Fantasy, and then they moved into these other games. The market needs 40K as that big game that's going to get the attention, draw people in, and then for the people it doesn't work for or that they just get bored of it or want to move on to something else, that's how they get introduced to these other games.
Okay. So it's got Uncle Mo on its side, and it's the needed gateway drug, I think, there. Okay, I like that. All right, so initial points have been stated. You know what that means? That means it's time to break your enemies down. So, gentlemen, I need each of you to tell me not only why you're right, but why the other two are wrong. And, Caleb, we will start with you.
Well, I'm right because it's obvious. What I've said is self-evident. You can look out into the world and see how big and powerful 40K is in the market. They have the lion's share. They're the big bad boys. And in addition to that, you have all these players who are financially entrenched in 40K. They can't afford to go out into these other miniatures games because a lot of their money is tied up in 40K. And Jeremiah, never take a devil's advocate position. Never do it. You don't actually believe in what you're arguing. It's a weak position.
You don't know that one. You didn't see my answer that I sent to Vince.
Terrible.
I was teetering on the edge.
Your heart's just not in it. I could see it. Sorry, man.
So give me more on that, Caleb. Why do you think GW won't drop the ball?
They can't afford to. I mean, they are riding on 40K. They are riding on it to be successful.
But they're not
Age of Sigmar, but what's providing the money for that is 40K. If 40K dies, Games Workshop dies. It's over. Done. Kaput. Forget it. Fantasy or Age of Sigmar is not going to save it. And I would refute Nicholas, but we agree.
you gotta see if you can make some space between you there.
Okay. Well, thank you, Nicholas, for repeating my point earlier about the 800-pound gorilla. That was very kind of you to add some oomph to my argument. I got nothing.
All right, Jeremy.
All right, well. Is it me who's echoing?
No, somebody's echoing. Maybe Caleb.
You need me to mute? Right.
There we go. I think we're good now. Okay. Yep, there we go.
Okay.
So, like I said before, my original answer was yes, just because there's that inkling of me, or that hope for me, that GW would actually be smart and, you know, be able to save themselves. But, I mean, they even said to themselves, we're not a gaming company, we're a miniatures company. So, yeah, they have the 40K rules and everything, but how long are they going to be like, oh, we need to sell more and continue to put out books? Like, Mantic right now, they have free rules. Avatars of War, they have free rules. All these new competitors are coming up. I've seen things on the YouTube pages or on the Google Plus YouTubers that a lot of the big tournaments for fantasy are taking the Kings of War approach. So, like I said before, there's a lot of people who have the ability to, that are like nipping at GW's heels, and all they're waiting for is the opening. And they gave it to him with Age of Sigmar, and Fantasy Battles is pretty much freaking over with, right? So when is it going to happen with 40K? They have Mantic has their Warpath. They have, like Nick said, Warmer Hordes or whatever has its own. It's not the big war machine or big war battles or whatever, but you can get. Again, I've seen games that are like 50-plus points or 100 points or whatever that have a crap load of models, and they are nice models too. They're not just like freaking, you know, put them all together and it just whatever. They're nice models. They're GW, I do agree, they have some amazing models. They have some of the best stuff out there, probably the best right now. But again, people are catching up, people are getting better, and they're just waiting to swoop in and take over. So, I mean, it's just an inevitability in my opinion.
Okay. So. All right, Nick, you have the last say in the final round here. Take us home.
All right, so I would say that the difference between both of my opponents and myself is that they're arguing from the position that GW has to eventually fail. But that's not necessarily true. I mean, there could be some sort of zombie apocalypse. in 6 months, and Games Workshop will die with the rest of us on top. So, I mean, I think assuming that if the future goes on indefinitely, eventually the company is going to fail, it's a weak argument because you could say that about anything. Oh, yeah, sure, once virtual reality comes out, no one will be playing with tabletop miniatures anymore, and of course GW will fail then, but who cares about that? We're talking about right now as the market is developing, and we're seeing more and more companies come out, but they're not directly attacking 40K. They are coming in on the edges, and yes, maybe they're hoping that GW is going to make missteps, causing people to, let's say, lose a little interest in GW and buy their models. Oh, you want to play 40K with a bunch of hot women? Buy my Kickstarter. You want, these guys who look really cool and have a specific theme that you can't get from GW? Buy my models. But they're still all betting on the 40K train continuing. And yes, you could say that, you know, maybe GW made a mistake with Age of Sigmar, but again, it's still too soon to tell. But they've got other stuff in the works as well. I mean, they've got the whole Horus Heresy and 30K. There's a huge multimedia empire built on 40K in the 40K universe, and nobody can even touch that at this point, even if they have a great miniatures game. And in the terms of the overall industry, all of those games and all of those manufacturers are benefiting from 40K being out there and being so widely distributed and so well known.
All right, I'm gonna call it right there. I've got my winner. Okay, that was a well fought round. A lot of good points. I liked everybody's arguments, but in the end, somebody pushed me over and they've got the point. Caleb, I still have like a little slight echo, so you might want to just a little bit. And that is Nick. Nick, you won me over, buddy. You got the point for round one. So what pushed me over the edge was pointing out that it's a gateway drug, and what really sold me was when you said, look, you got Horus Heresy, and people are chomping at the bit for that. That was a good call out. Like, the moves they're making seem to be right. I mean, the excitement over that thing is ridiculous. I don't understand it, but people are frenzied for that. And at the same time, when you said even their opponents want them to succeed, I think you're right. They know that they can't live in a world without the big dog. So that ended up pushing me over. So, Nick, you are the winner for round one. All right. Woo. Okay, let's move on. Round two. All right. So Warhammer Fantasy Battles had a colored history with their RPG. If anybody's curious about that, I highly recommend a book called Designers and Dragons, written by Shannon Appleklein, which has a great history of the entire RPG industry. And there's a huge section on GW, and you can learn all about that there. But at any rate, let's just say it was a rough path that the Warhammer Fantasy Battle role-playing game has went down. And what I would like to see, and currently right now, obviously, whatever exists, isn't still matching to the current Age of Sigmar. So what I want to see is a new RPG. I want you to pitch me your RPG based in the Age of Sigmar, and I want you to tell me who produces it. So this round, it is going to be Jeremy starting us off. So, sir, take it away.
All right. So I just literally got into D&D 4th edition. Very recently, haven't had much in the way of playing it. I think we got to like maybe three encounters, something like that. So I'm probably going to be on the bottom tier for this argument.
Okay, that's all right.
But I'll try my best. I would have to say, like, I'm going to go with just doing the regular, like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Go with D&D and just use those rules and use the Age of Sigmar fluff. And, I mean, like I said, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Just plagiarize the shit out of it.
So, in your world, is this actually a combination of these two powerhouses? Like, do Wizards and GW? I mean, Games Workshop started as a distributor for Dungeons & Dragons back in the late 70s and early 80s. So, there is some, you know, history between those two brand names there. So is this like a marriage of the two titans? Are they both returning to their roots? to make like an expansion world for D&D?
Honestly, I would have to say that yes, they. It would be like they did when they do when GW does any of their branching out to different game platforms. They like with all their video games and their like other like random board games that they had put out that weren't actually made by them, but right. they were the intellectual property owners, and they would say, "Hey, this is the rules we give you, and make a game out of it." And I think
so like Wizards a Battlemaster type thing, right?
Exactly. And I mean, Wizards of the Coast obviously knows what the hell they're doing, so just use that and roll with it.
All right, that's a strong world to live in, and D&D has certainly shown, and with the 5th edition, that they're more willing to bring a lot of differing campaign worlds out. So your argument may be stronger than even you know, because I do know the market for RPGs fairly well, and I know what's going on. So I like it. You got a good one. So all right. Nick, you're up next. What's your Age of Sigmar RPG and who's making it?
Okay, so the way I see Age of Sigmar is it has that inherently sort of heroic cinematic style and feel to it. You know, maybe a little bit elevated in that respect from the old world. But it also has the undercurrent of a little bit of horror in it, because you've got a history of the old world being destroyed, this new world being created, but chaos is still ever present. You know, when is its eye going to turn back onto the world, and when will it be ready? So I envision something by the Pinnacle Entertainment Group. They make a bunch of role-playing games called the Weird Wars series that are essentially sort of... They typically have done games based on historical wars with a little bit of a sort of horror fantasy element. And I think that would still be a good fit for Age of Sigmar. And the way I envision it is the PCs would essentially be playing Stormcast Eternals. Right? So they are these powerful, almost angelic forces that have been raised up by Sigmar and are the bulwark defending this new realm against the forces of chaos. But they have to contend with their past. Stormcast Eternals, for you know all their Sigmarine glory, were denizens of the old world who died, most likely in some horrific manner. You know, they had normal lives where they were people with, they had failings, they had good days and bad days, and that's still going to be part of them in their psyche. So I'm sort of envisioning that. It's the idea of that, yes, you're the Stormcast Eternals, you're the bulwark against chaos, but you've got that little nagging doubt, you've got that little weakness in your character that you've also got to overcome. Okay. And I think that's got the heroic element, and it's got a little bit of horror, and it's got good role-playing potential.
Okay, very cool. I like it. I like Pinnacle stuff. Yeah, that's good. All right. Good stuff. A little bit of a slightly more down the indie call. I like it. All right. GW has certainly proven that they're not afraid to work with smaller publishers in the past, both in the video game sphere and others. So I could see that. All right, Caleb, give us your pitch. All right.
Two things that make fantasy strong. One is its variety. It covers a lot of different genres, a lot of different things, good, evil, mutations, magic, heroic knights, everything you could possibly want is there. Second thing is the rule of cool. If it's cool, it's going to be in there no matter how silly or weird it is. And so you need a company that has lots of variety, huge amounts of rule sets to cover everything and every possible scenario, and the rule of cool. And there's only one company that has done that consistently, and that's Palladium Books. So what you do is you take the Palladium Megaversal system and you adapt it to Warhammer. And not only can you do that, you can have any story you want and combine any kind of characters you want. You want a bunch of normal humans, have hardly any skills or any fighting ability, and they build themselves up slowly? Palladium can provide that with the peasant rules. You want mutants? Palladium has an entire point-based system for creating mutants. You want all kinds of weird magic? Palladium has all of it. Necromancy, elementalism, everything you could want. They even have rules to create gods. So you can join Sigmar's pantheon and go into battle as gods against chaos.
All right. Just no loot. I like and it. That's... You... Oh, go ahead, Caleb. I'm sorry.
No, I'm sorry. I'm done. I'm done.
Okay, no, that's good. Obviously, I'm a big fan of Rifts. Been playing it for many, many years. I know we've talked about that before. One quick point I just want to clarify on yours. So we're using the Palladium Megaverse system. Are we assuming, then, that it sits in the universe? Because in the universe, the Rifts connect everything, right? I can take a Scraper and put him in Rifts, or a guy from Heroes Unlimited and put him into TMNT and so on and so forth. All these worlds cross over to some degree. So do Warhammer characters now have... Can I, like, be playing regular Rifts and Lightning Bolt in my Stormcast?
Everything is an option in Palladium, so yes.
Okay.
With GM approval.
All right, sounds good. I just wanted to see if I was going to be attacking some Coalition Spider Skull Walkers with my Stormcast Eternal. So, all right,
that's
good. I think that would
be all kinds of awesome.
All right. So, everybody's given a good pitch. Solid all around. Three good takes on this, but there can be only one. And so that means that the others have to die. So, Jeremy, start us off, sir. Why do you not like their two ideas? Why do you think it needs to be, you know, on D&D?
All right, well, I mean, first off, it's D&D. I mean, it's the godfather of pen and paper, RPGs, whatnot. For Nick, for your argument, is it, with an RPG, come on, you got to have variety, like Caleb said. You can't just have one, like, archetype or type of person to be and say it's, you know, it's imaginative. You just have one group, it gets boring. You got to have a little bit more. You got to have the necromancer, the warrior, the wizard, the thief, all that good stuff. You got to be able to tailor your character the way you want to tailor him. And having one archetype is just not going to do it. So, I mean, I'm sorry, but that I can't get behind on that one. Caleb, honestly, I don't know what – I've never dealt with Palladium, so I can't talk against it, really. But I'm working on just the fact that it's D&D, and it's been around for so long that – if it, like, I'm just going to keep going back to my same argument. If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Okay.
That's all I got.
No, that's good. All right. Cheers. There you go. All right. Nick, now to you, sir.
Okay. So, I have loved D&D. I played it a lot when I was a kid. Not so much in recent years, although I did play a little... when 4th edition was around. But my problem with your position is twofold. One, you say it's D&D, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And you made the variety point. But if it ain't broke, don't fix it, then why is anybody going to want to play an Age of Sigmar game when they could just play D&D? Your position is not going to give GW any confidence, because D&D already exists. So... You're saying it's superfluous to even have this game. And as far as the variety goes, that is in there. Yes, while I did say the players would be Stormcast Eternals, they could have any number of things in their backstory. You know, one Stormcast Eternal could have been a Dark Elf Slaver, and another guy could have been an Empire Pikeman. But even beyond that, that's what expansion sets are for. That's what other game books to come out later and make GW more money. As far as Caleb's arguments, I suppose with a powerful enough phone, if the 90s called, GW might answer. But I just don't see Rifts being a good fit. And here's the main reason. Games Workshop is infamous for its defense of its intellectual property. And now you want to sell it on the idea that, hey, we're going to take your beloved this world that you just created and you put all this time and effort into, and we're going to make it generic IP number 42 in our existing system. And maybe some players will play it, some elements of it, alongside the other cool stuff, you know, maybe with some Robotech or some mutants or superheroes. No, that's not going to fly. Games Workshop wants to be number one, top dog, They need their product showcased, not just thrown in with some other stuff as a favor.
Okay. Woof. That was some body blows, Caleb. I hope you know that. Nick just, he just spit some hot fire at you with that 90s call that GW picked up. I was trying not to laugh out loud while you're actually talking. Didn't want to interrupt. But that was pretty solid. All right. Caleb, you've got the final word, though, so take us home.
All right. First of all, you were arguing from which rule set for D&D? For 4th edition?
No, I said I had played 4th edition.
No, not you, Nicholas.
Jeremy, which rule set did you want to put it on? Are you talking about the new 5th edition, 4th edition?
Or I've only played 5th edition or 4th edition, and that's all I'm going to be going I can go off of, honestly.
Okay, fair enough. Having played 4th edition and at one point sold it in a store, I can tell you that's not going to work. 4th edition, all of the characters...
Well, let me stop you, because I don't want to hook him up just because he's only played that one. Let's just assume the successful... If 5th edition is current, it's very successful. I'll grant him just talking about the current.
Okay.
Thank you for the crunch.
There's a lot of bad blood towards Dungeons & Dragons in the player community. A lot of bad blood. There's so much division that the very name is poison. Some people still play it. Some people still get into it. But there are many, many who will not and will advocate that you do not play it, simply because of all the divisions that have occurred with the different rule sets. And honestly, I'm one of those people. I will never return to Dungeons & Dragons ever again, simply because of what Hasbro has done. Now, Games Workshop and Hasbro, they both engage in bad behaviors. I don't want to see them get together and transfer their bad behaviors to each other. I don't want to see that happen at all. Plus, you really do need the variety that Palladium can bring. Again, Dungeons & Dragons, two shoebox. You're too stuck in a certain path. There's not enough freedom, in my opinion. As for Nicholas, okay, yeah, fair enough. It's an older game system, yeah. There were some good things about the 90s, though. You know, it wasn't all bad. but at the same time, you just want to do Stormcast Eternals, okay? And they all have different backgrounds, okay? But they all have the same powers. Plus, your argument is that Games Workshop cares about its properties. That's true, but it doesn't really care that much when it licensed them out to another company. Because if that were true, they would have taken the license away from THQ for their video games a long time ago, long before the company went belly up. And they would have been more selective about who they licensed their role-playing rights to. And that's a rather weak argument from the role-playing perspective. Now, if they really wanted to be successful, they'd be careful and they'd research it, or they'd just do it themselves. But again, you want variety, you want the rule of cool, you want everything that Warhammer has, you've got to go with the guys who do that, and that's Palladium. None of the other companies can do that, or will do that.
All right. Boy, that was a strong round. That was really strong. And I'll tell you what, at one point in that argument, I was leaning toward all three of you. I really was. Like, all three of you had me on there. So, Jeremy, I love the concept of the Wizards Games Workshop team-up. You know, despite Caleb's point, if they both got some bad blood out there, look, they can just play that Taylor Swift song and say, take your bad blood, you people who don't like it, and go stuff it. We're still the kings in the industry, and everybody else is eating the crumbs that drop off of our sandwiches, and that's more or less true. And I love the idea of a return to the form of the early 80s when these two work together a lot. White Dwarf used to have tons of D&D material in it. But, and it's a big but, ultimately some of the arguments against it that were made convinced me about it, because it is such a hog as far as what it wants, as far as what Games Workshop would want it to be. I'm not sure that a single game book in the D&D world could actually even carry it. That being said, from Games Workshop's perspective. Now, Caleb, your argument's strong, and you're right. Nobody does Rule of Cool like Palladium. I agree. We're talking about a game that contains psychic assassins and Cosmo Knights and pixies and mini monkey assassin spies, and I could go on for 3 hours, all in one game system. And it is amazing. But Nick, he dealt you a blow from which you did not recover. I'm sorry. And that was that, and the one that really sold me, not the jab about the 90s was funny, but the one that really got me was, he's right. They want their game, they wouldn't want to dilute their IP by having it mixed into these other worlds. I do believe they'd want it to stand alone. And Nick, ultimately, wasn't your initial pitch, I'll tell you, didn't sell me that much until you said, we can sell expansions that offer more and differing characters. Now you're talking GW's language right there, because I can see the pitch. Look, it's a tight game. Think Vermintide, think these things. You play one type of thing, here it is. And then we're going to sell you 30 more books that let you play the other stuff. And GW looks at that and says, I like where your head's at. So, ultimately, he sold me, because if there's anybody looking to sell a lot of expansions just to play the game, I think we all know that that's right in GW's wheelhouse. So, that was the thing that put me over the end. That was what gave it to Nick. So, round two, going to Nick. Oh, Nick's pulling out ahead. 2-0. All right. Great round. Great round. Okay. Here we go. Round three. Okay. So, obviously, there's been a lot of discussion of the Ninth Age lately. And I think it's funny because, you know, we mentioned the South going to war and all this. And that's kind of actually moved the discussion. It overshadowed the Ninth Age a little bit. But I still think Ninth Age is a big deal. And there's a lot of work going into it from the community. And I always love community efforts. But here's my question for you. So round three, is the Ninth Age good for the hobby, and will it be successful in the long term? Okay, so it's kind of a two-part question. You can answer each of these individually. So, Jeremy, this round goes to you. So start us off. Is the Ninth Age good for the hobby? Will it be successful long term?
All right, so I've been in fantasy for a very long time. I love the game. I may not love exactly what they did with certain things within 8th edition. Like, I like certain, like the no pre-measuring for cannons. I love that in, I think it was 6th or 7th edition. I hate the laser cannons that they have in 8th edition. What I do love about the Ninth Age is I've read extensively on it, and yeah, it's basically the two groups that have tried to actually balance the game in separate way, like differing ways, which is the Swedish Comp guys and ETC. So the rule set is essentially the same, but they've tweaked the rule set just enough to where it's different, but not so different that it's not still Warhammer Fantasy. And they're also looking to go through and upgrade all the books, add new units, add new freaking stats and magic items, all that good stuff. And I know it's kind of like jumping on my initial argument with the first question, where we have all these other companies coming up nipping at their heels or whatever, but it's no longer Games Workshop that is writing all the rules, so you don't have somebody who's just going to drop their IP at the first sign of danger and, you know, shoot off. So I think it's got a big group of people who love the game, love what 8th edition was, but with some tweaks, and I think it's what we should, instead of jumping on the train with everything else, we should stick with fantasy with these small tweaks from 8th to 9th, to the 9th age, personally.
Okay. So yeah, you're saying yes, it's good for the hobby, and yes, you think it'll be successful long term, basically.
Yes, correct.
Authoritative yes. I like it. Okay. Very good. All right, Nick, you've got us up next.
All right, so I have sort of a split answer. So for me, when we're talking about the hobby, I see that as kind of a large and a loaded term. So the way I'm looking at the hobby is the overall miniatures hobby. You know, buying miniatures, assembly, painting, playing. Not necessarily GW specific or any one game. So I think that, yes, it's good for the hobby because anything that's going to keep people playing games is overall good for the hobby. So if we look at what the Ninth Age is, the Ninth Age is essentially a community response for the people who are rejecting Age of Sigmar. So while you have some that went the death, holy death route of, you know, burning their entire army, he hasn't left the hobby. He's still playing Warhammer Hordes, he's still playing Malifaux and other games like that. So, you know, even though he went on YouTube and burned his entire Dark Elf army, he's still in the hobby. So the hobby didn't lose him. So, you know, maybe we're going to see people play Ninth Age for a while, and I hope that it's successful because, you know, I like Once Bitten, and he's really looking forward to it. But I just don't see it as being long-term successful. And the reason is some of the community accepted Age of Sigmar at the beginning. Some have, as we've seen recently, a whole bunch of GTs have signed on and sworn allegiance to Kings of War. And then you've got the people doing Ninth Age. And the problem is going to be who's going to be able to keep the momentum. And in this large and fractured miniatures market with all these different games, is a fan-based rule set going to be able to command the attention? And I don't think so for this one main reason. Ninth Edition caters to a very, very specific niche, which is the Masters tournament scene. They want to run these in Masters tournaments, but the problem there is they're already bleeding some of the Kings of War, and where are you getting your new players from? Even if everybody in all the remaining tournaments says they're going to play Ninth Age, are they going to be playing Ninth Age in their basements, and are they going to be playing Ninth Age in the store except when they're maybe doing practice games? Who is the new blood that's going to come in and pick up Ninth Age? I just don't see it. I don't see the existing player base of tournament-focused players being able to recruit enough new blood to keep this thing going in perpetuity. It's going to last a few years, ideally, but then I just don't see it able to handle the attrition.
Okay. All right, very good. So, yes, ultimately good for the hobby, or at least neutral, but in the long run, just doesn't have a long future to it. It can't get the new blood in. Okay. Caleb.
Okay, so I actually had to look up Ninth Edition and read about it because I wasn't even interested in looking at it until you mentioned it in the question. And I already have a slight bias against it because their grammar is terrible. And as a former English teacher, that was just...
Well, to be fair, most of them probably aren't English as a first language, so it's probably running translation.
Okay, well then that's acceptable. It's okay. Just I read Cannot Never, and it was just it almost made my blood shoot out of my eyeballs. Okay, well, that being said, though, I mean, if people can remain civil with each other, if there's no addition wars, like there have been in previous games in the past, then yes, it can be a good thing. It can keep people's imaginations going. It can keep people in the hobby. It could be a good thing. However, on the other hand, if it creates more divisions in the community, if it creates people fighting against each other, flame wars, no, it's not a good thing. And it will lead to people who would otherwise play games with us turning away, because we're all going to look like a bunch of psychopaths who set things on fire. Do I think it'll be a success? Well, what tends to happen to older versions of games that are not supported by the company? They slowly begin to fade away until you have a very small number of diehards playing the older editions. And what happens to fan-made editions? They don't ever really start. they don't last. And I'm just looking at history. History is telling me that will Ninth Age be successful? Probably not, simply because of what I've seen before.
Okay. All right. Strong arguments on all sides. All right. So, now it is time to crush your enemies, to see them driven before you, and to hear the lamentations of their women. So, Jeremy, start us off. Why are these two gentlemen wrong? Why is Ninth Age both good for the hobby and going to be successful in the long run?
All right, so one of the things that Nick had mentioned was the fact that everybody's, you know, gravitating towards the Kings of War that for the new tournaments and everything. I understand that, but you also have to understand that Kings of War has had their rule set coming out and has had it established. I think they've got version 2 or something like whatever the hell they call it has come out, and it's established. The Ninth Age has just come out, and they're still working the kinks out and everything like that. So, to me, I think once the people who have played it in all the GT, who've played 8th edition through Grand Tournaments, actually gets their hands on 9th edition and plays it, I think that they'll latch on and go, okay, this is what I'm used to. This is I'm used to this enough to where I can, you know, get back into the Ninth Age and stick with it. Now, in regards to the whether or not it can be sustainable, yeah, Caleb, you said that it's one of those things where it's not supported by a game company, but you have Kickstarter, right? And I don't know the whole legal ramifications of going with a Kickstarter to make Ninth Age. Maybe if they rename it something other than Warhammer Fantasy Ninth Age, like Manic did, you can freaking get a Kickstarter going, and I guarantee you there'll be plenty of people who'll be like, oh, hey, Kickstarter, we can get some free rules and all this other cool crap that I'm sure they can come up with to throw into, like, the pledge manager or whatever. But I think, honestly, with the new blood is going to be the people that come in during the tournaments or the guys who are practicing for said tournaments in the game stores playing Ninth Age rules. And right now the Ninth Age rules are free to download. So somebody comes up and goes, hey, what game is that? Say, oh, it's Warhammer Ninth Age. Here's a link to, or here's where you go get it. Just Google it or whatever. And I mean, like I said before, GW makes amazing models, and you can still use Age of Sigmar models for Warhammer Fantasy. You can still use Mantic models for Warhammer Fantasy, just like everybody's been doing forever. So I think, honestly, it's going to be good for the hobby, and there are going to be diehards that stick with it no matter what, but I think that there's going to be enough diehards that will be playing it in game stores and able to be pulling in new blood enough to where it's like, hey, start a small army. And because I think Ninth Age actually has a 1,500 point and lower rule set for like skirmish type play, if I'm not mistaken. I don't remember exactly if they have it or not, but still, it's one of those things. It's, you see a big game like that in a game store, you're going to want to play it. That's how I got into it as a younger adult kid, if you will. And they, like I said, Kickstarter, I think, is going to be the way to go from now on with miniatures. I mean, I just did the Reaper Bones miniature Kickstarter. Got a crap load of stuff for models for that. So is there with the sustainability, in my opinion.
Okay.
So that's my stance.
All right.
Rebuttal.
No, sounds good. I like it.
Also.
All right, Nick, you're up next. Why are these two fine gentlemen so wrong?
Okay, so I think there wasn't really too much difference between any of us on the hobby aspect. I think mostly we're going to find the root here in the viability issue. And I think that Jeremy is just way, way too optimistic here. You know, when we talk about the Kings of War,
gotta hope, man, gotta hope.
And all that, he talks about, like, they need time to get the kinks out, but they don't have time to get the kinks out. You know, we've already discussed in previous questions, you know, how this, the miniature market is moving rapidly. It's definitely still growing, but this is the ultimate underdog. This is a fan-made adaptation of a dead game. How do you sell that to people and say, give this a chance, when there are alternatives out there that people are playing? You know, when you come up to someone and say, hey, that's cool, what game are you playing? So now we're talking about people who don't know anything, right? We're talking about people who are brand new to the hobby. And then you've got to sit there and explain to them the whole history of Games Workshop and why you need to buy the models from this company, and then go and find a Kickstarter for these really cool models from this other company, and then you're going to go and find a website and download rules from somebody totally unrelated. The Swedish cabal made these rules. They're really cool. They're gonna think you're crazy. They need to get in there quickly and establish themselves just to stop the bleeding. We're not even talking about being able to expand. And again, you know, we talk about getting your hands on. There's going to be no physical copies of the stuff. This is going to be go to a website and download these rules that are made by these guys in Europe for this other game. I think it's a very esoteric concept to try to sell someone who's new. And the whole Kickstarter idea, I think, would fail because, A, people are already pissed off about the Age of Sigmar. So the people that are going to be your Ninth Age, you know, market are the people that are already pissed off at Games Workshop about Age of Sigmar. Now you're talking about, hey, you're going to pay us money to maybe get some rules that maybe you could use, and now that there's money involved, you think Games Workshop's lawyers are not going to maybe perk up? I think they're fine to let the Ninth Age slide as a fan-made thing that's going to be on the side. But I just don't see it as something that's really feasible for them in that respect. And Kings of War, you know, you could argue that, you know, a lot of people maybe don't like Kings of War, or they've just got their new rule set art or whatnot, but at least they're an established company with a physical presence and, you know, and professionally published rules. Now, then we get to the viability of the game in general. When you're talking about everything that Games Workshop did, people were all over the internet screaming about. What sort of moral authority is the Swedish cabal going to have when you change things that they don't like? When they released that first alpha slice, the internet lit up with, oh my god, I can't believe they did this and that, and why'd they change this rule? And, you know, you did have some voices of reason, like once bitten out there saying, hey, give it a chance. I may agree that some of these rules they changed seem a little bit wacky. But, I mean, they changed a lot, which they probably needed to do to differentiate the IP. But now, you know, now they've got to sell everybody. They've got to herd the cats. This is not just Vince trying to get three guys to sign in on time for a show. This is, you've got to convince all of these tournament organizers that this is worth a lot of their time and effort and money, and then you got to convince the whole GT circuit that this is worth their time and effort and money to go to these events. You know, people travel for this stuff a lot of times with these GTs. This is not just like, hey, what are we going to play tonight in our basement? You know, you've got to convince people that this is worth a lot of effort. And then that doesn't even tackle getting in new blood. I just don't see the viability.
Okay. All right. Very strong. All right, Caleb, you've got a final word.
All right. Well, we've talked about viability. We've talked about sustainability. Let's talk about affordability, which is a really, really important point. To get someone invested in any kind of miniature game usually requires a fairly significant investment for most people. I mean, you're talking dropping $50 to $100. Then spending money on paints, brushes, then time and effort, all of that costs money. You are not going to get that kind of effort for a fan-made game, or a fan-made rule set, nor are you going to get that kind of effort from an old system. to bring in, speaking new blood strictly. Now, us old gamers, us people who've been around a while, we'll do that because we've done it. The initial pain is gone. We're addicted. This is how it works. But I just don't see Ninth's sustainability. I really don't. Not in the foreseeable future.
All right. So I don't have a decision yet. And here's what I'm going to say. I think, Jeremy, I think the two of them sort of teamed up here, and they've won me over on the non-long-term viability. But I don't know between the two of you, between Caleb and Nick. So you both seem to agree it's not long-term viable, and you've quoted many of the same reasons. So let's see if we can lever more of that. It might be bad for the hobby. Because, Caleb, you're the one that was saying that as well. So why don't we start out, Caleb, why don't you say why you think it could be bad or what could be the bad consequences of it? And Nick, let's see why you think, then we can go ahead and speak back to that as to why it's good. How about that? So Caleb, start us off.
All right, well, you have a niche market. Let's face it, miniatures are a niche market, a very small niche market. And then you fracture that niche market, and then you fracture that niche market again, and you fracture it again. There's only so many ways you can slice this pie and it be sustainable. This slices the pie even more. This is bad because it harms the hobby. If miniatures are not profitable, if they're no longer profitable, companies won't make miniatures anymore. Nice talk. And I completely lost my train of thought there.
If miniatures aren't profitable, companies won't.
And furthermore, if the community is divided, if the community is volatile, if the community lacks the friendliness, the warmth that I've seen in this community, which could very well happen as a result of a divided community, this will push away new blood as well. You don't get people to come into a hobby by being angry, by being volatile, by being jerks. You just don't do it. So the more united we are as a community, the better it is overall for the game and the more new blood we can bring in. We don't need any more divisions.
All right. So Nick.
Okay. So let me talk about those points. I don't really see the divided community in the same respect that you're talking about. I mean, what I hear from you is sort of the whole edition wars concept. At least from where I sit, I'm not really seeing that, because what's happened is this isn't a bunch of people fighting over what is the sole greatest edition that everybody needs to play. We're actually seeing a much different breakdown, where the people who are going with Ninth Age or Kings of War or whatnot, they're the people generally that are focused on the competitive tournament circuit. And the people that have embraced AOS most vocally are the people who are more interested in the hobby aspect and the story aspect, and not so much. I mean, a lot of the commentary on this channel, on MC1 Gamer's channel, a lot of the pro AOS stuff was forget about tournaments. You know, let's just look at this game for what it is. So we're not seeing that kind of violent edition wars that's dividing the community. We're seeing maybe a little bit of segregation, but we're not seeing volatile conflict. Now, as far as the economics factor, I think it actually is much more in my favor. Yes, miniatures need to be profitable, but that's not really going to be an issue either way here. I mean, if all of these various forms are successful, they're all buying models, and that's floating the boat. The other thing is, though, what's good about the idea of this sort of fractured community where all these games are being supported, at least in the short run, is it's actually propping up the secondary market for miniatures. If all of a sudden everybody who is playing fantasy just drops it like their death, holy death, or a hot potato, and it's only a small group of AOS players left, then that secondary market crashes like it's 1929, because No one's going to be using these models. No one's going to want to buy them. And no one's going to be able to unload them. As long as people are playing Age of Sigmar, Ninth Age, Kings of War, as long as these things are going, there's actually still a market for these models. You can go into Bar Town, people are still buying fantasy. You can go talk to Materium's wife about getting your models painted. She's still backed up through April. The hobby is still strong, regardless of Age of Sigmar being dropped like a bomb in our laps.
Okay, we'll call it right there. That was good. That was a good round. A lot of good points there. In the end, I'm going to go ahead, and I've got to give the point to Caleb this round. Nick, your argument was really strong, but what Caleb sort of made me think, and I think you're right, in this community and where we've been here, I think it's been pretty good. I think most of the YouTubers are pretty positive. But looking at a lot of the broader market, I have seen a lot of, like, out there when I look on Facebook, Twitter, and those kind of things, there is some toxicity out there, and I worry about that when I walk into the game store, when I walk into a tournament, and people are just like, you know, like, you say the wrong thing, the addition that people don't mention, and you can see the discomfort begin, and that gets me uncomfortable, because what you want is exactly what Caleb said, that warm, welcoming, positive environment. You want to walk into the store, a bunch of people playing the same game, and you want them to all say, hey, look at how great this is, come play this with us, you want to be here. So, although it might not be true, and this isn't my personal opinion, Caleb, I think, gave the strongest points for me, and so he gets the point this round. All right. All right. Round four. Round four, as we know, is the showdown round. So here's where we pick some of the greatest things from the Warhammer universe, and we pit them against each other in a clash not unlike what we're engaging in right here. So this round, this week, showdown, round four, the Cauldron of Blood versus the Screaming Bell versus the Blood Throne of Khorne. That's right, it's the Big Stuff People Ride On edition of Showdown. I know everyone's excited. So, Nick, you've got the first go this round. Start us off.
All right, so I am going to be attacking this from the Age of Sigmar perspective because that's the game that we're in at present, or at least the latest incarnation of Warhammer. So I am going with the Blood Throne of Khorne. It is solid. And I'll address its main weakness first. It has the fewest wounds. However, I think that is more than mitigated by the fact that it is going to confer upon the Chaos player the ability to summon more. So this is a strong vehicle that is going to put a hurt on things. It's got most of its attack with a killing blow type effect still. And it's also the fastest, because its speed is in no way connected to the loss of wounds. And it can regain wounds. So, I mean, just from a pure game perspective, I think this is the strongest option. From a fluff option, this is the Chariot of Chaos. Chaos is the strongest force in the Warhammer universe. Now, people may be hoping that in Age of Sigmar that changes, but everything up to now is chaos. So when you see this thing on the field, you know that you have to fear, because chaos ate the old world with these things at its vanguard.
Okay. The Blood Throne. All right, I'm a big fan. By the way, I have all three of these models converted, so let me just state that out of the gate. So I have no personal favorites in this, maybe. All right, at any rate, Caleb, you're up next. All right, fair enough. There we go. Okay. All right. All right, fair enough. Jeremy, you've got your batting cleanup this round. Take us home. Oh, nope, can't hear you.
All right. There we go. Which button I had hit. All right, so, Caleb, I thought you said you were going to leave that for the next round to, like, hit us. All right, so I'm going with the Screaming Bell. For obvious reasons, because I wanted to win points with Vince. But, anyways.
I like your tactics.
All right, so here's my thing. If you've read any of the fluff with the Skaven, you know that the bell is the thing that gets them, like, ramped up and frothing in the mouth, ready to tear shit up. The one scene I want to point you to is from the End Times Thank Hell book, right? And they're assaulting, I believe it was Altdorf?
Nuln.
Where they had Nuln? Okay, they're assaulting Nuln, and they're just, the entire Skaven army is just rushing towards the last safe place of the, with the Empire, and they have, I'm pretty sure they had, like, a handful of the Screaming Bells being pushed up, and as they're pushing up, they're chiming as they get closer, doom, 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 and every time they hit, they're freaking getting even more and more bloodthirsty, ripping each other apart, getting closer and closer, cannons are shooting off, and you see one cannon cracks right into the actual bell itself, and is ringed, like, giant ringing bell of doom, and it hits 13 times, and on the 13th one, they get up in there and they just run over and don't care about the losses, don't care about anything, and they just get in, and it's the centerpiece of the army, both as a model and both in fluff, or as well as in fluff, and it's just one of those things where if you were to be present, I don't care who you are, unless of course you're Chaos, because they're my boys, they're my army, are going to shit yourself. You're going to shit your pants, because what are you going to do against a horde of rats with a giant bell being rung by a giant freaking rat with a crazy rat on top of it shooting spells, turning your buddies into freaking rats as well? You can't do anything about that. Like, it's literally doom coming. It even says it when it rings it. So, there's my argument.
All right, no, that's nice. That was a great scene in Nuln. That's a good reference. You didn't mention it, but I'll give you the credit for it anyway, since you're referencing the whole scene. On that strike, the entire, like, factory section of Nuln collapses down into the tunnel that had been dug, right? And, like, the earth swallows Nuln as its doom truly comes for it. Yeah, one of my favorite scenes in the entire End Time series, so yeah. Strong argument. The bell plays well there. All right, but now it's time to impact hit your enemies. Segways. All right, so, Nick, start us off. Why are the other two not the right choice here?
Okay, so with the Cauldron of Blood, you have the... His argument was aesthetics-based, which is fine. Everybody has their opinion of aesthetics. However, the problem with the aesthetics-based argument is that it can be utterly refuted with a one-word answer, which is conversion. Don't like a giant penis? Make something else. That's it, right? If all you're looking at is looks, you can change that. You have the power. So let's look at the Cauldron of Blood. So it is. Hey, you know, it's got a lot of knives on it, and it's got a lot of chains on it, and whatnot. But again, you know, that's still just an aesthetic flavor. But In the game, is it really giving you that much more power than anything else? I don't know. It's tough to start with, but you know, in Age of Sigmar, I actually think it kind of comes in second to the Bloodwrack Shrine nowadays. So it doesn't have the preeminent place that it had in the previous edition, and it's going to get bogged down, and it's going to get dragged down, and it's going to get weaker as it loses wounds. It's a nice centerpiece in your army, but it doesn't have the punch on the table that it once did. And again, as far as the Screaming Bell goes, that's the slowest of the models out there, unless you surround it with a horde of rats, and then maybe you're going to get the same speed as everything else. You know, and then even if you're looking back on its grandiose heyday in 8th edition, you know, what, the top of the Screaming Bell is where Grey Seers go to die. I mean, you know, it was just, why didn't people play them as much? Because cannons. Now, if we address the bonus point given by our hosts, yeah, you know, it's pretty cool when the Screaming Bells rang and Nuln was swallowed up. But if you read ahead a little bit, you'll find that when the Forces of Chaos rolled out with those Blood Thrones, they swallowed the entire world. So I think that takes precedent, and the victor is going to write the history book. So I don't think they're going to write too kindly of the Screaming Bell. And now if we're going to go back and look at the Cauldron of Blood from the fluff perspective, yes, they are the altars of Cain, the god of murder. And what did he do in the end times? I think the elven gods were reduced to petty argument and doing a whole lot of nothing. The god of murder just sort of took a powder.
All right, Caleb, you've got next. So tell us about the cauldron. Why are these two wrong? That's up to you.
I agree with Caleb.
Let's go again. For the blood throne.
The thing no one uses.
Keep track of what we're actually talking about.
Okay. All right. Jeremy, you have the final say in this round. So, why are these two wrong? Why is the Blood Throne and the Cauldron of Blood not the choice? And why does the bell ring us home?
All right, so I'm going to stick with Caleb on the whole. We're going off of the model that was given, not the convertibility, because you can make anything look badass. I mean, you can see right behind you, Vince, your badass double bell right there as well. Yes. I mean, if you want to go convertibility, Caleb, there you go, right there. Looks 10 times better than both anything you can make at a Cauldron of Blood or a giant penis demon throne. So my thing we got with the throne, I like how Nick went to, we're going to go with the rules for Age of Sigmar since it's the present one, because if you go with the 8th edition rules, it's just the biggest bag of crap ever. Because you see people use the Cauldron of Blood. You see people use the Screaming Bell. When have you ever seen anybody use a Blood Throne? Come on. I think I read up on the rules of the Blood Throne when I was trying to figure out which one I wanted to pick. And the Blood Throne is... It makes Bloodthirsters okay. Or Bloodletters, sorry. Okay. And they're already crap. So why would you put something in that's just going to make something mediocre that no one uses already any better? I mean, yeah, it's a chariot, and it can, you know, give the bloodletter some extra crap, but what's the point? It's like nobody uses bloodletters, so what's the point of having a blood throne? Plus, again, it looks like a giant demon penis with guys riding on it, so nobody's going to ever use that. Caleb, everybody uses the Cauldron of Blood with the 8th edition rules. Now, I don't know about Age of Sigmar because I haven't played too much on it. I've been in the middle of moving, so I don't know. But with the 8th edition rules, the only way people run the Cauldron of Blood is in a giant horde of witch elves. And you know what you do with a giant horde of witch elves? You throw chaff into it, and it doesn't do anything the entire game. Or if you're the Empire, you shoot cannons into it. That's all. With the Screaming Bell, I mean, Nick tried to use the, you have to throw it into a horde of Skaven in order to make it actually move the same speed as everybody else. But that's what you do. You throw it in there because in order to get all the points for the Screaming Bell, you have to kill both the, or if in order to get the whole points for the general, who is usually the Grey Seer riding on top, you have to kill both him and the Screaming Bell.
Well, so unless you're mixing you have cannons,
say again.
You're mixing additions.
That's okay.
Hey, I'm rolling back and forth.
He's comparing my AOS argument to an 8th edition argument. I mean, sure. Argue one or the other, argue both, but don't say my AOS point doesn't work in your 8th edition argument.
Well, I'm just going with both with what I know. And I'm just saying I pulled your argument or the Blood Throne into 8th edition. So, but still, if you're going to try, like the only way you can really take down a Screaming Bell is with a cannon. And if you're a good Skaven general, you have two Warp Lightning cannons, which are going after their cannons. So, normally, and with 8th edition rule-wise, you're going to be freaking laser cannoning shit, and if you're not, you have a Storm Banner popped up, so they can't shoot your shit. So, in the end, you have Crax Call coming with the Skaven, all that good stuff, and you're not going to get through a horde of freaking Skaven. It's just not going to happen. So.
All right.
Drop the mic.
All right, good battle all around. But in the end, there is only one, and I think I know who the winner is this round. And I can already hear the cries of partiality coming. But Jeremy, you are the winner this round.
Yeah, I got a point.
The narrative in the first one. And his argument of nobody uses Blood Thrones was a really strong one that took, yeah, like that was a really good point.
In 8th edition, maybe.
Sure, that's fair. That's fair. Unfortunately, no one could use it in AOS either because they all had to run out and buy the model since no one actually owned one.
There you go.
Before they show up on the table. And he took out the Cauldron of Blood with just the good use of like chaffing witch elves and not been, you know, it's not fun that fun either. But the big tower, you know, it's fine. It's fun and exactly what he said. Played right in those tactics. It's strong. And ultimately, he gave me the total package. So, Jeremy, you got the point for round 4.
Very package.
There you go. All right. And I can already, you can put it in the comments of how I partial this game since I've got this thing sitting behind me. You can, but the Blood Throne is sitting right over there with the cauldron, so, like, whatever. It's fine.
Hey, don't worry. I picked Cauldron of Blood first, too, and
technically, I picked Cauldron of Blood, too.
You all picked the Cauldron first. I would just like to say that.
You, I play Dark Elf.
Sure.
We all know the true power of the Cauldron.
Sure. It's, but,
I will say this. I have had a Cauldron of Blood destroy itself. It's called Dangerous Terrain and Frenzy.
Sure. Yeah, yeah. Yep, overrunning over some DT. Oh, it, there it went, wrecked itself over a rock. All right. That brings us to the final round. Going into the final round, it's a close game. You got anybody's game here. Caleb at 1, we got Jeremy at 1, and Nick at 2. So if Nick gets his point, he wins outright. If one of the other two of you get a point, we go into the speed round.
Okay. We just got to gang up on Nick.
There you make sure your counter-arguments are strong. All right. Round 5. I love a good starter box for a game. And I have bought many, many starter boxes in my time. We've talked about bringing in new players a lot here. And I think that often the true success of a game can somewhat be defined by the quality of its starter product. That's true, I think, across the board. Because you've got to make it easy for new players to start. And so that leads us to the round 5 question, which is, what is the best starter box ever released for a miniatures game? All right, starting us off here in the final round is Caleb. So, Caleb, you've got the first bite at the apple. Okay. All right, simple, strong, easy, good value for the dollar. I like it. Jeremy, you're up next.
All right. I'm going to kind of go out of the box on this one.
I love out of the box.
Got to go out of the box. And go with the one starter kit that got me into Warhammer and basically tabletop miniatures period or in general, and that's HeroQuest. Sure, everybody here has played it before. It's a no. I would say go ahead and try and eBay it, but it's like $500 to just get the original game. Luckily, I still have mine sitting on the shelf over there. But it's basically a board game with four players. It's like kind of a D&D-esque game where you have a dungeon master. And you have your heroes. And then it has a full campaign, and it has the ability to actually have the DM make his own rules and everything. It comes with crap tons of models. And it shows you how to role play. It shows you how to DM. So if you want to get into D&D, you can go straight into D&D. For me, the way it happened with me was I loved the Chaos Warrior models. Like, they were amazing to me. And for me, like, a lot of the modeling perspective for me is just the way that it looks. If it looks badass, I'm going to go with it. And I saw the Chaos Warrior models, and I thought they looked awesome. I painted them up myself, even did a little conversion on some of the original models. And then when I started working at a hobby shop and found out about Warhammer Fantasy and saw Warriors of Chaos, I was like, boom, right there. Same thing, and I'm pretty sure that HeroQuest was a GW-made game that they used to pull people into Warhammer Quest. So, and I may be wrong with that, but that's what I kind of feel like I remember hearing. But either way, you have your elves, you have your humans, which one of the humans is a barbarian who looks extremely, extremely close to Sigmar with a sword. So, it's kind of like rolls it into the Warhammer thing and the fantasy or the tabletop miniature game. But honestly, HeroQuest was the game that started me on all of tabletop, and that's for me was the greatest starter set that I've seen since, because everything else is just miniatures. This, like, I mean, yeah, you have Age of Sigmar or whatever, cool, but HeroQuest was just a full-on RPG plus miniature game, and still love it.
All right. That is strong. I will say HeroQuest was released in 1989, and it was the gateway drug for me into D&D and the broader world of Warhammer and all that. So that was my gateway drug. I got HeroQuest, and then a couple months later, I picked up D&D for the first time. So I feel like I can certainly understand what you're saying for it. It was the gateway. It was the starter. All right, Nick.
Okay, so I decided to go also sort of outside the more usual suspect scope, and I'm going to go with the Malifaux starter box. Because I think, even though it's a newer product and it's relatively small compared to most of the starter boxes out there for miniatures games, I think that it delivers exactly what a starter box is supposed to deliver. It comes in at an extremely competitive price point of $65. It has everything you need to learn how to play Malifaux and play it. It's got two decks of the cards. It's got the rules. It's got measuring sticks, and it's got scenarios that are designed to specifically teach you how to play. So I mean, this box set, you could, in theory, take you and a friend. You've never played Malifaux before. Maybe you've never played any miniatures games before, and this will teach you how to play the game without having to have an expert friend teach you how to play the game. You're getting only 8 models, but you're getting 2 factions, and that's all that you need to play a little game of Malifaux. And the beauty of the starter set is, so beyond that market, beyond the, hey, these are people who've never played before, and you can give them something that they can actually use, you know, unlike trying to hand somebody who's never played a game before Island of Blood. The models, as designed, are even useful for experienced players because they fit perfectly into their respective factions. They fill a niche that the faction doesn't already have, and they're all mercenary models, so anybody playing any faction in perpetuity can have a good use for these models. So the combination of the price point, the intended audience, the ability to actually deliver a starter game complete, and ubiquity and usefulness to any player of the game, from the newest to the most experienced who's already got everything else. That's what the Malifaux starter set brings.
All right, that's pretty good. Apparently, Caleb, somehow you were like muted or volumed down during this round, and people didn't hear you. So I'll just like really quick. I think I fixed it. I know I saw what happened, but just real quick, we'll go to you to take down your enemies, and just you had picked the Age of Sigmar box set, so we'll restate that quickly. So why is the Age of Sigmar the best? But more importantly, why is HeroQuest? Why is Malifaux not the choice here? Go ahead, kick us off.
Well, very few people outside of the old school gamers, like you, myself, have actually heard of HeroQuest, first of all. So it might be a good value at the time, but now it's sitting at $500 on eBay. So it's no longer a good value. I mean, I don't know of anybody who's going to pay $500 to play an old game. So that may have been the case in the past, but as far as now, no, not at all. I mean, Jeremy said that and went, no, nope, I'll just live in ignorance. I'll be very happy. And $500 richer. As far as Malifaux goes, those are some of the hardest models I have ever seen to put together. I really shudder to think at what a novice player...
The starter set models?
Huh?
The starter set models?
Oh, just any of them in general. The starter set model is easier to put together.
Yes.
Okay, well then, that's my profound ignorance speaking. All right. I just, for the money and for the amount of miniature you get, it's very difficult to beat the Age of Sigmar box. It's just this gigantic thing, full of just really cool stuff, full of iconic figures that even someone outside of a wargaming understanding would look at and go, oh, I recognize this. Guys with hammers, angels, horrific monsters coming in covered in skulls. Great stuff.
All right. Very good. Hopefully, and I think that's fixed, so everybody should have heard that loud and clear. I apologize for any technical difficulty. All right, Jeremy, you're up next. I could hear you fine, so it won't influence my vote at all. Don't worry, Caleb, you're good.
I could hear you. The war of argument, I could hear you.
There you go. All right, Jeremy, why is HeroQuest the best? But more importantly, why do these two just not know what they're talking about with all this newfangled stuff? Why do we got to go back to 89?
All right, so to clarify, Caleb, the question was, what was the best starter game ever? Not current, but ever. So, the price now is probably my biggest talking point, because that's how amazing the game was. It's $500 amazing. You won't see Age of Sigmar be $500 amazing down the road, because you won't see Island of Blood or Malifaux be $500 amazing down the road, because there's 100 different things like it. So, I'm not going to lie, Nick, I have no, I've heard of Malifaux. I think it uses, like, playing cards or something like that for your, like, how to fight or something like that. I have no idea. The models look kind of cool, but for me, it's one of those things, it's like my childhood was molded by HeroQuest. And that's something that's got me into, like, 15, 20 years of Warhammer and other tabletop-type games. So, yeah, Age of Sigmar has some badass freaking models. I'm not going to lie. Like I said, GW puts out some good stuff. But, and granted, like I said, HeroQuest was a GW game. But the way that HeroQuest dropped you into the lore and the environment of a fantasy game just drew you into everything. It had the traps. It had finding, like, the walking into a room and having a gargoyle sitting there like, hey, what's up, bitch? I'm gonna fuck your day up. And it was just the most immersive game for me at the time that brought me into loving tabletop. So for me, HeroQuest is the best starter game or starter set ever.
All right. Very good, Nick. You have got what could possibly be the final argument of the final round. So
okay. So first, Jeremy was correct when he said that we were talking about the greatest box set. However, if we're continuing the clarification, we're talking about
HeroQuest is a box.
We're talking about war games. The show is about tabletop war games. HeroQuest is a box, yes. It's a board game.
And the question is.
GW may have been involved, it's a board game that was the lead-in to tabletop role-playing games. If we wanted to take your assertion as correct, then we might as well all pack it in, because Monopoly was the greatest box starter set of all time, because the car and the hat are the most iconic miniatures in all of American gaming.
If
and
you hate your grandma.
So, we're talking about war games. So then I'm just going to skip that and we'll go on to the AOS starter set. Yes, the AOS starter set is good value for the money. But again, it's got a $125 price point, and it is of no value to anybody if you don't want to play Stormcast Eternals or Chaos guys with bulging triceps and thighs.
Who doesn't love that?
It's a great set, but it doesn't deliver universally. Now, you made a crack at Malifaux's models that some of them are very difficult to assemble, and I certainly will admit that. We're not talking about what game is the best game. or who's got the best models overall. This is not an argument about does Games Workshop have better models than Weird. This is who put together the best starter box set. And as I had pointed out, the Malifaux starter set delivers on every point that you want to have for a starter set. Everybody can use the models in the Malifaux starter set no matter what faction you're playing. You can use them today. You can use them next year. You could use them if you're playing Arcanists. You can use them if you're playing Neverborn. You can just flat out use everything in that box always. Yes, if you are going to play Stormcast Eternals, the starter box is probably a very good deal if you have a use for the Chaos models. If you're going to play Chaos, the starter box is a great deal. If you have a use, if you're going to split it with somebody, sure, you know, and keep half the box yourself. You can keep the entire box of the Malifaux starter set, and it's going to be a very good value for you. That's what I have to say about that.
All right. Okay.
Oof. Can I interject one thing, Vince?
No, you may have a little final word. I'll give everybody one little final word since it's the last round. So, Jeremy, start us off.
Just
go ahead.
Real quick thing for you, Nick. The question that he emailed out was best starter box ever released for a miniatures game. Not a board game.
It's a board game. Read the Wikipedia and see what it says about it. It says it's a board game.
Are we citing Wikipedia now?
All right. Very good. Anybody else have any other clarifications?
And it has every single model for every single Warhammer or miniature game you can think of. Just saying.
It did have skeletons and orcs and goblins and Chaos Warriors. I do remember those Chaos Warriors well, certainly. Okay. I allowed it, so I'll agree. It is, like, I you know, he sent me the answer, and I said, okay, you're starting out of the box, so you're going to have to put up with people hurling slings and arrows at you. But, so that comes with going outside the box. But, I wouldn't, if it was dismissible, I would have dismissed it already. So, okay. But I can take into account the fact that it's not traditional. All right. Any other final clarifications that anybody wants to make?
Yes, since we're going to accept that, which is fine. But let's just say it's not a starter box for anything. It's a self-contained game.
Okay. All right, Caleb, any final thoughts?
No, I'm just sitting back and enjoying myself now.
All right, I'm ready to decide. Okay, all three of these, honestly, are strong answers. I think that each of you made really good points for all of yours. So, Nick, your arguments about price point being very friendly, like $65 for the Malifaux starter box, good. The fact that those models are universal, that is to say you can use them as a new player and as an experienced player, those are strong, strong points. Caleb, value for dollar, like weight of plastic, Age of Sigmar is one of the best of all times, right? I mean, it really is. Like, the models are really cool, the rules are very simple, it is good for a brand new player. I mean, and the number of stories on the internet of people who are like, I never played before, and then I got Age of Sigmar, and I love it. It's doing what it's supposed to do. But ultimately, I'm going to give it to Jeremy. Jeremy, he gets the point for HeroQuest. He went out of the box and he sold me because people addicted, and it was a gateway to the hobby for role-playing, for tabletop miniatures. And he said, he looked at that Chaos Warrior, it was a Chaos Warrior. And you went to the store and you saw the Chaos Warrior on the shelf in the Chaos Army, and you were like, oh, wait, hold on, there's more of these things? I can do a whole army of these things? That's a good gateway drug. It's doing what it needs to do. And it was a super fun game. It made you addicted. It made you want more. And that's what he pointed at. So I got to give it to him. So that's going to throw us into the speed round. All right. Caleb, excellent performance. And you're gonna help me out here, because I'm going to, guess what? You're going to get to be a stand-in additional voice judge here in the last round, okay? So here we go.
Awesome.
All right. Ultimately, the decision's going to be mine, but I'm taking what Caleb says very seriously. He's going to be my voice of reason. Here's how the speed round works for people watching and for both of you. In the speed round, what's going to happen is I'm going to say an X or Y type of thing, okay? Like, for example, apples or oranges. And the first one of you to shout out an answer defends that thing. The person I hear first is the one who gets the thing they yell. If you both yell different things, fine. If you both yell the same thing, the person who yelled it out first gets it. Okay.
Is my mic on?
It is on. So if you yell at, like, if I say apples or oranges, you both say apples, but, you know, Jeremy, you say apples first, you get apples, and Nick, you get oranges. You're each going to get about 30 seconds to sell me on your thing, why your thing is the right answer, okay? And literally, I'm just going to tell you A or B. So your arguments can be whatever justifies your pick, okay? And the person who said first goes first. You get about 30 seconds, then you're both going to get a back and forth. So it's going to go A, B, A, B. All right, where you can sort of answer each other. A little 30-second back and forth. Do we all, the speed round probably takes longer to explain than to play. Does everybody understand the rules of the speed round?
Yes.
Got it.
All right. Here we go. Speed round question. Okay? Here we go. The speed round question is Neferata or Kalidia?
Neferata.
All right. Jeremy, you've got Neferata. That means that, Nick, you are defending Kalidia.
Here we go. That one.
So, basically 30 seconds. Jeremy, start us off. Neferata.
All right. Neferata, Queen of the Vampires. She helped with the downfall of an entire civilization and is still alive to this day. Well, if you don't count the end of times. But Kalidia, I mean, come on. She's an archer. What do you got there? You're an archer. All I got to do is sidestep, and I dodge your crappy little arrow.
All right.
Three vampires, the first vampire. Got to say, she has everything, including her skin, comparatively to Kalidia. So.
Nice. It's a strong hit. Okay, Nick, you've got Kalidia, so go ahead. 30 seconds.
Okay. So Kalidia, yeah, you're right. Her sister was turned to a vampire first, but Kalidia was saved by the gods. And yes, on the tabletop, she's the Archer Queen. But again, who were you seeing playing? Since you were making the argument that no one played certain models, Kalidia and archery models with Tomb Kings, still very strong.
Okay. So we'll give you each a little rebuttal to each other there. So, Jeremy, you got just a few seconds. Go ahead, give me some more strengths and hit Kalidia a couple times.
Tomb King archery models. That's pretty much an argument in itself. I mean, yeah, you get 5 up to hit in 8th edition, but you're not going to have an entire army full of archers. You have Neferata. She's on a giant freaking badass model. She gets into Kalidia, and she's going to eat that thing alive.
All right, Nick, you've got the final word.
All right. So Kalita's not a coward. Neferata accused her of falsehoods, and she defended herself personally.
Okay, that's good. That's good. There was good narrative, good rules. I like that back and forth. All right. So this is a tough call right here. So Caleb, based on sort of, you know, their arguments alone, not any personal feelings about these two models, not that anybody would have any personal feelings about these two models. That would be ridiculous. Caleb, what's your who are you picking? Who you throwing your weight behind? Who won on the strength of their arguments?
Well, let's take a look. On the rules side, Jeremy was quite strong, except that a Tomb King's archer army is versatile. I've seen battle reports where they've won tournaments. As far as the fluff goes, I mean, Nicholas was very strong presenting Kalita's great character and the flaws in Neferata's character. Now, Neferata's a coward. She hides behind everything. She's a manipulator.
Told you, it's a tough call, right?
I'm going to have to go with who has the better story, because at heart I'm a story guy, and I always side with the heroes. So I'm going to go with Nicholas.
Oh, okay. All right, so you've sided with Nicholas, so now I got to take that into account. I got to think about that here. Well, you both gave really strong arguments for your character and for the rules. And in the end, though, I honestly think that Jeremy sold me a little more on Neferata, and it pains me as hell to pick it, because I am a Kalidia man at heart. But he sold me at her big-ass monster. She's the queen. She's this manipulator. She's still alive. She brought down an empire. That's all true. She was the first vampire. She has this great legacy, and he hit me on all of those points. Whereas I didn't get as much of the legacy of Kalidia and how, yes, personally, she had this great moment, but he hit me with the full legacy. You know, we got one good performance out of Kalidia, but we've got a Lifetime Achievement Award out of Neferata, and he threw that up there for me. So, well argued, both of you. That was super close. I mean, like, honestly, I could have put a razor down there. That was fantastic argumentation from all three of our players, and certainly really great last round. But Jeremy, you, my friend, are the winner and the War Games champion for the next 2 weeks. Well done, all three of you.
Congratulations.
All right. There
Very
we go.
Surprising to me, honestly.
You started out a little rough, but you came back strong, and that's what's important. It's not about the start of the race, it's the finish line. There you go. Yes, that's there it is.
Got me from the rough start to the finish right there.
There it is. Had to get a little more of the brain cells loosened up. I get it. Absolutely. Yeah. All right. Gentlemen, thank you all very much. Certainly appreciate it. Everybody have a good time in the show.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, definitely.
Thank you, yes.
I enjoyed it. I had a fun time.
Absolutely. Was it a little harder than you expected? A little more exhausting?
A little bit. I thought I was, personally, I thought I was out of the running when Nick got two in the first, in the very beginning. I was like, crap. I was like, the third one, I was like, please, Caleb, win this one. If I don't win it, Caleb win it. Because then I have some sort of semblance of a chance. And I won the last two, and I was like, I'm back in.
I wasn't going to win that last question, because I just didn't have the knowledge.
I swear to God.
Well, then you got that curse of the top table.
Sorry, say again?
I was saying, oh, there's also that curse of the top tables. You know, coming out strong in the beginning, this doesn't necessarily help you at the end.
Yeah, I swear to God, I did not pick Vince's brain prior to this. With the Screaming Bell and Hero... Like, I knew the Screaming Bell, obviously.
Right.
But the Hero Quest, that was kind of like... That was for me. Like, I loved Hero Quest.
Oh, yeah. When I saw Vince's face light up and you said Hero Quest, I thought, he's one.
You're like,
hey, no nope. Arguments, not my bias. Come on, I picked Neferata in the end. You know how much that killed me?
I watched it kill you, man. I wondered if you were gonna go through with it, so I decided to give you a little push just to see what would happen.
It was the stronger argument.
In all honesty, with the whole Neferata Kalidia thing, when he said Neferata, I was thinking Kalidia. And then as soon as you said Kalidia, I was like, shit, that's not the one I wanted. And then I had to like step back and go, okay, I read the books, I read the like all the Nagash books and everything. I love that series, and it had the like whole like storyline of Neferata and Kalidia and all that. And Kalidia was a badass. Don't get me wrong. But I had
I'm weak on Tomb Kings in general. I had to really reach.
Everybody has to reach with Tomb Kings. Come on now.
And I'm whoa. Let's watch those superlatives getting thrown around at everybody.
There's something that
Wait,
I was that
can't
I wondered.
Step back on your
events. You love Kalidia so much, but you mangle the pronunciation of her name. You always call her Kalidia.
That's fine. It's close enough. I mangle the pronunciation of everything. It's all not Skaven, names.
It doesn't matter.
Exactly. That's just my natural Skaven accent coming out. It's very hard for me to speak your man tongue. All right. That's what it is. All right. Gentlemen, thank you all for coming back, or for coming in. And, of course, when we do the Battle of Champions, that means, Jeremy, you might have to come back for the when we do the Winner Showdown. Yeah, that's what you get yourself into when you win. But I would love to have all of you back on at any point in time. You're all great, great master debaters, and I would love to have you back. So, gentlemen, thank you very much for everybody out there watching. Thank you all, and as always, we'll see you next time.